Welcome! My name is José van der Hoorn, Clinical Director of Ventinova Medical, and it's my pleasure to host our second webinar. Please welcome Dr. Nabil Shalik, Senior Consultant of Hamad Medical Corporation in Doha, Qatar, Assistant Professor of Weill Cornell Medical College of Qatar and Qatar University. Thank you for being able to share your clinical experience and to show some excellent cases, how you handle, how you manage this severely stenotic trachea. So you will present some spectacular cases in the next 30 minutes. And after that, we have some time for a Q&A session. So all attendants who are now viewing this presentation, you are able to ask your questions in the chat function. Scroll down and ask your questions, and I will ask them afterwards to Dr. Nabil. Also in this chat function, a poll will appear to provide to ask for your feedback on this webinar. So please, Dr. Nabil, start your presentation.
Okay, thank you, Josiah. Thank you, I will start.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, good evening. We would like to thank you for attending this webinar. Also, I would like to thank the organizing committee for their kind invitation and making this event successful. Tracheal stenosis has been noted as a cause of upper airway obstruction for well over 100 years. Laryngotracheal stenosis is difficult to treat and has different etiological factors. So my topic today is tracheal stenosis management. This building is Hamad General Hospital, part of Hamad Medical Corporation, Doha, Qatar. You can see Hamad bin Khalifa Medical City, part of Hamad Medical Corporation, Doha, Qatar. And this is ambulatory care center inside the medical city, contains our operating theater, difficult airway clinic, difficult airway skill labs, and most of our airway cases were done in this building. First of all, I don't have any conflict of interest related to this topic, but I have to declare the following. This event is sponsored by Ventinova Company. Ventinova Company gave us Yvonne machine as a demo, and it's consumable since March 2019. Unless cited, the contents and conclusion of the following presentation are solely those of the speaker. We will talk about causes and diagnosis of tracheal stenosis. The most recent cause is COVID-19, post-intubation tracheal stenosis, surgical and airway management and the limitation of some techniques, ventilation through straw-sized tube, dry tube, using flow control ventilation. At the end, I will show some interesting cases that will be managed by dry tube, or dry tube plays an important role or change the management completely of these critical airway cases. What are the causes of tracheal stenosis? This include and not limited to the following causes: congenital, inflammatory, traumatic after necrotherapy. Post-intubation tracheal stenosis is well-known risk of prolonged endotracheal intubation. An incidence of 4.9 cases per million per year is estimated for post-intubation tracheal stenosis. Stenosis commonly occurs at the cuff of the tube, intrathoracic trachea, or at the level of the tracheostomy stoma, extrathoracic trachea. Also, compression from outside may be happening, like tumor mass compression of the thyroid gland. In COVID-19 patient, the cause might be from ischemia caused by prolonged intubation as a source of initial injury, leading to scar formation. Overinflated cuff, prone positioning ventilation might contribute to the mechanism of underlying stenosis. Tracheal stenosis in the patient who are underwent orotracheal intubation is estimated to be 1 to 2%. We have in our center case series of 8 cases and the last 2 cases done this week. Bronchoscopic examination in COVID-19 shows markedly fibrotic inflamed granulation tissue in thyroid trachea. The current literature estimates the incidence of post-tracheostomy tracheal stenosis ranging from 1.5% to 2.6%. At the moment, there is no scientific evidence on which of the 2 procedures, open tracheostomy or percutaneous tracheostomy, is preferable for COVID-19 patient.
But it is too early to define the extent of any difference among COVID-19 cohort of patients and non-COVID-19 patient. Management of tracheal stenosis includes diagnosis, airway management, and surgical techniques. Diagnosis includes clinical exploratory or biphasic stridor. Ridged bronchoscopy can be used for evaluation of tracheal stenosis, the length and diameter. Flexural bronchoscopy can be also be performed, yielding additional information regarding dynamic collapse of trachea. Stereo vision, using flexible bronchoscopy with two lenses that appears to be able to accurately measure the diameter of tracheal stenosis. Diagnostic advances, particularly virtual endoscopy or virtual bronchoscopy and the 3D reconstruction of the upper airway, can help us in diagnosis. And provides non-invasive evaluation with high sensitivity and specificity, 92% to 100% respectively. Virtual bronchoscopy may someday replace airway endoscopy for planning purposes. Pulmonary function tests can help in diagnosis of upper airway obstruction. Again, thanks to new technology, thanks to virtual endoscopy and 3D reconstruction of the upper airway, because it helps us a lot in diagnosis and the management of post-intubation tracheal stenosis in COVID-19 patients. This first case of tracheal stenosis and its virtual endoscopy from inside, another case. We have series of 8 patients of tracheal stenosis post-COVID tracheal intubation and managed well because of the help of 3 endoscopy and the new advances in airway management. This is a facial expression for anesthesia team after taking history, physical examination, diagnosis of tracheal stenosis, and needs airway management. Surgical management includes the following: open airway reconstruction, tracheal resection with primary cricotracheal or tracheotracheal end-to-end anastomosis. Open airway reconstruction have traditionally been the treatment of choice for this condition in the past, and now this open procedure are still required in cases of mature scar, high-grade stenosis, and long segment stenosis. Airway dilation with balloon to manage airway stenosis have been emerged and becomes popular. Laser can be used to cut the fibrous tissue. Stenting have been used as the last resort for difficult case of tracheal stenosis. Development of novel airway stents to include bioabsorbable products hold the promise to decrease the morbidity of stenting procedures. Ultimately, advances in tissue engineering and 3D printing may provide yet another reconstruction option in the future. Adjuvant medical therapies include topical steroids, aerosolized steroids, systemic or locally injected can be used, spray cryotherapy, local application of mitomycin C after dilation, anti-reflective therapy by proton pump inhibitor like Nixam can prevent the recurrence of stenosis. What are the airway management techniques? Depending on the severity and the location of stenosis, types of surgical procedures, there are a variety of choices for perioperative airway management, such as face mask, laryngeal mask airway, tracheal intubation with microlaryngeal tubes, intubation with tri-tube, apneic technique, jet ventilation, stri-fi technique, or ECMO. Aortic dilatation already tried in some centers. Airway management difficulties of tracheal stenosis include endotracheal intubation, which is even small size microlaryngeal tube size 6, has outer diameter 8.8 millimeter, and is not visible in the presence of stenosis with a small diameter. Another option is by alternating extubating the patient during the operative portion and then reintubating for ventilation. So tri-tube, which has an outer diameter 4.4 millimeter, can pass this critical airway stenosis. The other possible approach is tracheostomy, but it was technically difficult to bypass the stenosis, and there was a potential risk of restenosis after closure due to the same factors that contributed to the development of first stenosis. Jet ventilation is another choice for management of these cases. But the problem was with 100% oxygen during laser application, which carries the risk of airway fire. But
There are automatic G ventilators that offer possibility to jet with FiO2 between 20 to 100%. Also, even with using manual jet ventilation with 100% oxygen, it is possible to suspend the ventilation and let the surgeon operate during this apnea phase. ECMO might be expensive, impractical, and sophisticated technique for management of tracheal stenosis, but sometimes life-saving technique. Stryfi technique will overcome this maneuver, and we can use it to insert a tri-tube or to complete the operation by this technique. Another option is awake tracheal dilatation, and we will discuss later. Stryfi technique is the abbreviation of spontaneous respiration using intravenous anesthesia and high flow of oxygen for induction and maintenance of anesthesia. Anyone who is interested to master this technique should read this paper carefully. This is placement paper for this technique. The Stryfi technique is the use of concept of spontaneous ventilation during stepwise target controlled infusion of propofol, using the predicted propofol plasma concentration minus the predicted propofol effect oxide concentration equal 1. This is a very useful table commonly I use for Stryfi technique. You can see here the TCI propofol started by 3 microgram per ml for 5 minutes, then gradually increased to reach the anesthesia plan for surgery. So the main concept is keeping your patient spontaneously breathing with TCI propofol only, and this is the main concept of this technique. What is tri-tube? This straw-sized tube is a very thin tube with outer diameter 4.4 millimeter and inner diameter 2.4 millimeter. Cuff lumen to inflate and deflate the high volume low pressure cuff that can be inflated by 20 ml air. Second lumen, which is an intratracheal pressure measurement lumen for continuous intratracheal pressure measurements. Third lumen, which is ventilation lumen, which is less than 3 mm in diameter. The advantage of tri-tube, very thin that can bathe the stenotic area of the airway, helps the surgeon to perform the surgery by giving wide surgical field in the upper airway surgery. Precaution during its use, tri-tube can be ignited by laser beam, can be kinked with airway instruments, and easy to be obstructed by secretion due to its small lumen. If the tracheal stenosis segment is very low, it is difficult to keep the balloon and the tube above the carina, and easy to migrate to one main bronchus, and the result is one lung anesthesia, like my patient yesterday. What is the Evone? Evone is the flow control ventilation machine, the only automatic machine in the market that can be ventilated through tri-tube with full ventilatory parameters. Flow control ventilation mode is a unique ventilation technique in which inspiration as well as expiration and control, that means actively performed. This is achieved by generating continuous flow into the patient's lung during inspiration or continuous negative flow suctioning gases out of the patient's lung during expiration. Also, you can see in the slide the Ventrain, which is a manual device to ventilate through the patient's lung using a tri-tube. This building is our ambulatory care center at night, part of Hamad Medical Corporation. Our operating theater, difficult airway clinic, difficult airway skill labs are located inside. I did all the following cases of tracheal stenosis inside the ambulatory care center. You will see now some interesting cases of tracheal stenosis. The first case is application of laser and balloon dilation of tracheal stenosis caused by tracheostomy. The clinical details of this patient: 50 years old female with tracheal stenosis after tracheostomy. History of malaria complicated with renal failure, respiratory failure required ICU admission and tracheostomy. Patient started to complain of dyspnea after closure of tracheostomy and diagnosed as tracheal stenosis. Tracheal stenosis at the level of second and third tracheal rings. Patient posed for tracheal balloon dilation after laser cutting of the fibrous tissue. The treating option and the airway management, mini tri tube, but can be burned with laser. Need ventilation, but if IO2 not decreased, airway flare can happen. ECMO strive high technique. Airway management done in this case using strive high technique. You can find here the vocal cord is relaxed, patient is continuous breathing. After spray of the vocal cord and trachea with local anesthesia and application of propofol TCI. You can find here tight tracheal stenosis, laser application to cut the fibrous tissue. And at this stage, I decreased FiO2 40% to prevent airway fires. Here, surgeon is passing the balloon through stenotic area. This is first dilation using the balloon. Diameter here after first dilation. Second dilation using the balloon. This is after tear dilation, nearly normal trachea. The second video shows another surgical treatment option of the tracheal dilation by using drilling of the scar tissue and then mechanical dilation by rigid bronchoscopy. You can see virtual endoscopy of our airway. This is fly-through technique. You can see the trachea here. Stenosis started appears at the end of the trachea. This lower tracheal stenosis. This is stenotic area. And this part you can see endoscopic view using rigid bronchoscopy about the same lesion and same place of the stenosis. And after that, the drilling stenosis at 12 o'clock using drilling technique. Drilling at 12 o'clock finished. Another drilling at 3 o'clock. The last drilling at 9 o'clock. Surgical cutting of the fibrous tissue between the holes. Then mechanical dilation using rigid bronchoscopy itself. This technique already done under rigid ventilation. And you can see here the trachea. Almost normal after dilation. This is an example of tracheal stenosis caused by huge cancer thyroid, compressing the trachea from outside and makes critical tracheal narrowing. We published this case last month. The clinical details of this patient is 4 years old, male, not known to have any chronic illness, but obese, 43. Weight 107 kilogram. Patient attended difficult airway clinic with difficulty in the breathing from huge thyroid mass with neck swelling caused stridor and caused metastasis in the sternum. Patient orthopneic After nasal endoscopy examination shows big mass vessel in nature, looks hard, occupying the right side of the trachea, starts from the cricoid region to the level of 7th tracheal ring. 3 mm fibroscope bust with difficulty. We did virgil endoscopy, 3D construction of the airway for evaluation of tracheal stenosis. We found 4 mm. Patient busted for total thyroidectomy, excision of sternal mass, possible tracheal stenting. We had many difficulty in this patient, obese, strider with exertion. Tracheal mucosa looks vascular in nature. Tracheal stenosis 4 mm in diameter and orthopneic. Tracheal stenosis caused by huge thyroid mass. You can find here the 3D reconstruction of the upper airway. Found here, this is the mass compressing the trachea. Virgil endoscopy of the patient. Again, reconstruction found the mass effect. Metastasis in the sternum. The cancer is eroding the sternum. Examination of the airway using strife height technique found here the stenotic area is 4 mm. This old area of obstruction. Here passing the tri-tube under fiber optic guidance. Confirmation of the tri-tube below the stenotic lesion and above the carina. Then ventilation of the patient for 6 hours using Evon and the tri-tube. We have a series of 8 cases of tracheal stenosis, post-COVID tracheal intubation, and post-COVID tracheostomy. Most of the cases was managed well because the help of tri-tube and the Evon machine. For your information, the last 2 cases done last week. You can see in this video the first case of post-COVID tracheal stenosis, airway management done by jet ventilation. ECMO lines were inserted in the groin of the patient as standby. Why we use ECMO in this patient? Because stenotic segment is very long, very low in the trachea, and very tight. So tracheostomy option is in emergency airway is extremely difficult, blood other comorbidities of the patient. Surgical technique performed, mechanical dilation by using rigid bronchoscopic dilation, then balloon dilation. The second video of post-COVID-19 tracheal stenosis. You can see here the clinical data of the patient. This is 3D reconstruction of the upper airway of the patient. You can find the stenotic lesion here is 5.2 millimeter. Anterior with zero diameter 4.25 millimeter. Airway examination using strife height technique. Spraying the vocal cord by local anesthesia. Examination of a stenotic lesion by a small fibroscope. Normal trachea below the stenosis, carina here. We are keeping guide wire inside the trachea. The guide wire is used to insert a tri-tube over it. Here tri-tube under guidance of fibroscopic vision. Tri-tube in the place. Surgery started to cut the stenotic tissue around the tri-tube. You can see clearly the cuff of the tri-tube under the stenotic lesion. Now balloon beside the tracheal for balloon dilation. Nearly normal trachea after 3 times of tracheal dilation. Another case of post-COVID-19 tracheal stenosis. But this patient is post-tracheostomy case. You can find here tritube in place. The balloon inserted beside the tritube. Inflation of the balloon to dilate the trachea. This video of last intubation I did last week that is show both intubation tracheal stenosis in COVID-19 patient. You can see here anterior posterior diameter of trachea is 4.2 millimeter. Diameter here is 3.3 millimeter. Examination of the vocal cord and trachea under strife high technique. You can see here that stenosis at two level. This is first level of tracheal stenosis and second level of tracheal stenosis started to appear here. After that, you can find normal trachea up to the carina. As usual, I keep the guide wire inside the airway. I use the guide wire for insertion of tritube. At this stage, I started to paralyze the patient and give him muscle relaxant after incision of tritube and kept in place. Here tritube obstructing the stenotic area, surgical cutting of the fibrous tissue. Balloon dilatation 3 times. Please notice that during balloon dilatation, you have to stop ventilation because increase the pressure in the balloon will obstruct the obstruction and obstruct the ventilation completely. And you have to stop the Evon machine at this time. After 3 dilatation, near normal trachea started to appear here. Another treatment modality, which is awake tracheal dilation under topical anesthesia and done as office-based procedure. I will let you enjoy by watching the technique and listening to the patient during the procedure.
Okay.
So not bad.
I can feel that.
You may be able to feel little parts of this. That's okay. That
doesn't mean
that doesn't mean anything. Okay. Yeah, don't go on. Wire back some more. And hold your breath right there. Don't breathe, don't breathe, don't breathe. Go. Keep playing alone. Keep playing alone. And play alone. You're okay. You're okay. And you play.
In conclusion, laryngotracheal stenosis is difficult to treat and its etiological factors are different. Nowadays, the most common ones are post-intubation or post-tracheostomy stenosis. COVID-19 tracheal stenosis has been noted as the most recent cause of tracheal laryngeal stenosis. Depending on the severity and the location of stenosis, types of surgical procedure, there is many variety of choices for perioperative airway management, such as face mask, laryngeal mask airway, ETT, head ventilation, thrive high techniques, and or ECMO. Each airway technique has its advantages and disadvantages. Tritube and Evone are the most recent option and protect the airway during this critical airway procedures. This is the logo of our newly born difficult airway society, DAM Society, for the Middle East and the Gulf area. I hope we will be a partner of DAS, SAM, and EAMS. Before your questions, kindly scan these QR codes by your smartphone camera and do registration for DAM Society. Thank you for your attention, and please have a lovely night. I think this attractive subject will open your appetite for more questions.
Thank you, Dr. Nabil, for this excellent presentation. I'm really impressed by the cases you just shared with us. In the chat, I see some questions. First question, could you maybe comment on the selection criteria for using Tritube and Evone in the when you use it?
Yes, it depends on the other facility. Suppose I have patient with laser, and the laser is difficult to done in this patient. And they have tight stenosis like 5.4 millimeter, 5 millimeter. So I chose that this technique, Tritube and Evone, because the size of the structure of the airway.
And what about secretions? Because it's a thin tube that can easily be obstructed, or you mentioned can be obstructed. What about that? Do you have solutions or measures to prevent any obstruction by secretions?
Yeah, this is a nice question, Jose. I wait for this question because this is the inner diameter of the tube is less than 3 millimeters. So any sort of secretion will obstruct the lumen of the tube. We have many techniques can do. The first of one, give the patient glycopyrrolate, maybe have an hour before the operation. Make sure patient not have any cough before induction of anesthesia. Ask the patient to cough many times to clear his chest from secretion. This is before starting. But if having after induction, like today patient, I try to wash with some saline and do suction, and at this time work as well after the all these precautions.
Okay, and do you also sometimes use glycopyrronium, for instance, to
Yes, glycopyrrolate. This is the basic starting with Evone and the Tritube.
Okay, and what about the obese patients? You mentioned in a case it's well over 100 kilograms, and then a very thin tube. Is that then allowed to ventilate adequately, or is there hypercapnia?
Yes, like the case I presented of thyroid cancer converting is already the BMI 43. And I ventilated the patient this for 6 hours using the Tritube and the phone with all adult ventilatory parameter without any change in the airway pressure or anything. Also today, I did one case of tracheal stenosis today. The patient already is 108 kilo, around 35 BMI. Also not affected completely like thin patient. So it is helps me a lot in the case of tracheal stenosis in obese patient.
Okay, and what about COVID patients and aerosol generation? How difficult is it, or how are you managing that? Is Tritube helping you with that, with aerosols, or preventing any
At this stage, I couldn't tell you yes or no. Because why? Because no one tested now tracheal intubation and urolization after insertion. But in general, it can take the same risk of normal endotracheal tube, because still we have the high pressure, high volume, low pressure cup, and this can prevent any airway leak or urolization from the airway of the COVID patient.
I see here some questions. What is the requirement for awake tracheal dilatation?
The character of this one depends on the patient. If you have patient covert, patient can tolerate the procedure in awake. Also, they need expert surgeon, because not any surgeon can do for the patient. Need fast surgeon, expert surgeon to do it at bedside or office-based procedures. But it's dangerous. Need expert team. It will be around at any time to manage the patient.
Yeah. And then I have here a next question. When is the ECMO team? Is it always present? Is that always your alternative? Or in what patients do you choose to have this team ready for helping out if needed?
Not always. Usually when found the patient is easy to be tracheostomy for the patient, or the stenosis is high, no need for use tracheostomy. The ECMO team will be standby. But the case I presented now, the very low stenosis, very long and very tight stenosis, at any time if try to do tracheostomy for the patient will be very difficult and useless. So I use the ECMO as a standby around us.
Okay. Also here, did you get the opportunity to do pediatric cases with tracheal stenosis? And if yes, do you then have the same approach?
I used, but this is not tracheal stenosis. It is already laryngeal stenosis. And this means some recurrent bulimatosis. This is so recurrent viral bulimatosis. I did 2, 3, 4 kids using this one, but I used mainly the Tri-Fi technique, not using Yvonne, because Yvonne and Tri-Tube already not approved in the pediatric age group. So I am using the Tri-Fi technique instead of this one.
Yeah, and indeed the Tri-Tube is only intended for persons above,
yes,
40 kilograms. And what is the learning curve? I think because you explained the Thrive-High is a very, you need some expertise to do this. And also the Tri-Tube, how long did it take you to combine these both techniques?
No, not the curve is not so high, because this is this easy technique. Anyone can read the table, follow the table, follow this regime. You can do this Tri-Fi technique without any problem, especially if you have the Thrive or high flow nasal oxygen is around you. This easy can do this procedure without any complication.
Okay. So I think it's really impressive. I also saw the guide wire you used with Tri-Tube. What kind of guide wire was that?
Yes, this is another tricky question, Jose. Already, I started to use central line guide wire, but I found the central line guide wire very soft and easy to be kinked by tri-tube. But at these times, I brought one or two from urology department. This is already urological guide wires with soft tip. I use it very nice in most of all cases without any complication.
Okay. Nice. And can you also bend the catheter a little bit then, of the guide wire? It's bendable.
The little bit stiff more than center line guide wire.
Okay. How do we avoid a laryngospasm during Strive High or awake dilation? Any experience on that?
Again, this technique need highly expert cooperative patient, but in the laryngeal spasm, anything happen, you have to be standby around all team for intubate the patient and manage the patient.
Okay. Let's see. Is the approach the same for laryngotracheostenosis? So slightly high when it's in the larynx. Do you use the same techniques?
Yes, if you see the first patient already I presented, already the just subglottic. Today also the patient is subglottic, just around 1 inch below the vocal cord. Do same technique for the patient without any complication.
Let's see another question. The last patient seemed to be suffering. Is it real? So what's your advice to have a better experience for the patient?
Yes, advise him to under general anesthesia.
Okay.
That's my advice.
Okay, that would be a good advice. Maybe this patient would be happy then as well. What's the effect when the dilatation, when you leave, you showed that you leave tritube in place in the trachea. What's the effect of leaving the tube in place during the dilatation? Does it affect the result?
No, because this is the size of the outer diameter of tritube is 4.4 millimeter, not affect completely, but you have to at this time stop ventilation and the deflated cuff of your tritube, otherwise the surgeon will rupture the cuff for you.
Okay, and you mentioned that the ventilation is then paused because otherwise the tube is
compressible. Yes, compressible, and it can be obstructed easily.
Do you then pre-oxygenate the patient and then leave? How long does it take?
At these times I increase FiO2 for Yvonne for 100% for 2-3 minutes, just flushing the lung of the patient.
Yeah.
And after it's on, ask the surgeon to do balloon dilation, subventilation for around 19 seconds, 2 minutes, and after then resume ventilation again.
And also, this is just doable in also the obese patients. It's no problem.
Yes.
Any size.
Yes. Today, no problem happened today with patient.
Okay. There are some nice compliments for your presentation. Thank you, Dr. Nabil. Excellent videos. Let's see. Drilling and cutting can cause bleeding. What if that happens? What do you do?
You have diathermy around, you can do cauterization of bleeding. But the fibrous tissue always not contain blood vessels. But again, you have diathermy around. You can do monopolar diathermy. No problem. Big issue.
Okay. That seems
even normal dilatation. Even normal dilatation can do some bleeding. But you have to be ready by diathermy or some issue of cauterization.
Okay. Let's see. Did you ever use tritube with laser procedures?
No, I'm afraid. And I asked Dr. Dittmar to find some solution for this one, but I think it's still under experiment or something like that. But I will be afraid to laser using tritube.
Yeah, also tritube. Not laser resistant, so we also do not recommend it to be used with a laser.
Yes, especially if burned for you, it may be detached and difficult to retrieve the burned part from the patient. Please don't use laser with tritube.
I can only agree on that. Is the surgical procedure done in one sitting or needs more than one?
Some patient improved from first time. As example, the first case of tracheostomy of malaria patient already we dilated 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
And some patient already 1 time is enough. But the COVID patient, fortunately, only 1 time is enough for them. This is what happened for 8 cases I did.
Okay. Did you also try to intubate, try to nasally?
Yes, I tried to use it nasally. No problem for you can use it. But you have to do a good vasoconstriction first and go through the nasal cavity. And it's very easy also because this is you can pass in the normal tube 7.5, but now 4 millimeter, it's very easy to enter. But need some expert person to do it, not from the first time to do.
Okay. And I also have a question here on Ventrain, the handheld ventilator with the same ventilation mechanism, can it replace Yvonne if Yvonne is not available? Do you agree on that?
It depends on you. If you are expert enough to do, you can do it. But in my center already, I did many cases like tonsillectomy for 30 minutes only for just take the sense of ventilation. But usually I use it as standby at the ambu bag. If a problem happens with Yvonne and already have one machine, is a demo from the company, if something happens, you have something to ventilate your patient through tritube. So I use it as ambu or manual solution of Yvonne.
Yeah, so only when Yvonne would break down or whatever, then it's a backup for your...
Yes.
Yeah, it can be used, but indeed, if you do the procedures you now showed, I think take longer than 10 minutes or 30 minutes. And
you can do.
Yeah. Let's see. Do I have... I think we have answered a lot of questions at the moment. Can you maybe also comment a little bit on the, in the last part of your presentation, you mentioned your airway management society?
Yes, this is a DAM society, already the non-profit society for the Gulf area and the Middle East area for MENA. I have many participants from Gulf area, from Pakistan, from India, from Egypt, from Lebanon. The main concept like SAM, like DAS, like EMS, like Airway Management Academy, just to teach the people, train the people how to use the new technology in airway management.
Yeah. And then you just take care of the whole Middle East in this? You represent the Middle East?
Yes. So now we are partner of most of international societies, and we hope we can do some meeting with each other, like WAM, like all of this in Qatar, in collaboration with the DAM Society.
Yeah, that would be great, I think, to bring together all the knowledge. Let's see. Oh, there's another question. Did you need post-operative ventilation?
No, because now if you see the patient already ventilated by 5 mm tracheal stenosis, if they let the patient become 8 or can accept tube 8 or 7, no need for ventilation at all. But if you have patient with tracheomalacia, like the patient with cancer thyroid, already we kept the patient 48 hours of ventilation to overcome the tracheomalacia of the patient.
And do you consider these as high-risk patients for extubation, or do you sometimes leave an exchange catheter in place just to make sure you always have an airway?
Something I forgot to tell during my presentation is tri-tube itself. Tri-tube itself, you can keep the very thin tube, can keep in the retromolar space of the patient, put in the blaster, patient can accept it, like in exchange catheter, like N3, like VBM exchange catheter, but soft, patient can respirate, can, this is your vent, you can anytime you can ventilate through it and easy accepted by the patient.
Okay, so and then you deflate the cuff and leave tritube in place, and you can also talk
yes.
a little bit to the patient how he or she is feeling.
Yes.
Okay.
Especially you can put the blaster on the angle of the mouse and keep it for any emergency airway situation for half an hour, 2 hour, no problem. Patient can accept it, tolerate it well.
Oh, that makes life easier maybe.
Yeah.
Would you please give more details about stri thigh?
Yes.
You are using local anesthetics only for the glottis?
Yeah. First of all, the stri thigh technique, already this is new technique, already started 2015 by both from Australia. Okay. I did many cases. I now reached out 200 cases using this one. I just finished this week one research using comparing the normal technique with tri technique. I already have YouTube video. I can send the link in the chat box if you want to learn it. You can listen the because this is need 30 minutes to describe for you the technique carefully. But instead of this, I will put the YouTube link in the chat box to open and see it carefully.
Are you the only? Is your whole department using these techniques, or are you the only one?
Yes, only one, maybe in the Middle East.
The very experienced Dr. Nabil. Yes. What analgetics are used?
Sorry.
What analgetics are used? Yeah.
Yes, analgesic for this stri thigh technique usually is enough spraying local the vocal cord with local analgesia. But sometimes I can add little fentanyl if they have patient obese, have patient higher active airway, but not so much, maybe 50 mic, or sometimes 10 or 20 ketamine with this one. And recently I started to use dexmedetomidine. Dexmedetomidine have very good effect. It's keep your patient's breathing, decrease the analgesic effect, keep your patient's spontaneous breathing, decrease the requirement of other narcotics. But the mainly the analgesia given to the patient is spraying the local anesthesia with 4% or even 5% xylocaine with vasoconstrictors. Every half an hour, it's enough for you to do the operation.
Okay, good. Then I think we had a lot of questions, and I think we answered them. You've answered them all. Post-operative analgesics.
Myself, usually I use and give non-steroidal anti-inflammatory with some paracetamol, multimodal analgesia, but I am not using so much narcotic for this type of patient. If I use, I use a small amount and keep the patient under observation over the night.
Okay. Okay. Then I think I will ask the viewers to please provide feedback in the poll, which is available down in the chat function. And if there are no further questions, then I would like to thank you, Dr. Nabil, for this excellent presentation and for being able to answer all these questions. Also, the attendants, thank you for watching. This video will be available soon on our website, also on our YouTube channel. So please fill out the poll in the chat function.
I have last comment, Jose, before closing. Yeah. I would like to thank my department because our department make good support to bring the new machine in the markets, supporting all technical staff. I have very good technical staff. Without them, I couldn't do anything. Plus my surgical team, I have cooperative surgical team. Without doing arrangement to be operative for all type of the patient, we don't succeed like this. So I thank him from my heart for all their effort for do all these cases successful and life till now.
Okay, well, yes. Well, thanks again. Our next webinar will be scheduled for March. We will make the announcements via our website and on our social media accounts. Please have a nice evening.